They don't have something to eat. They were grumbling because their life seemed better while they were in Egypt. They were talking of the pots of flesh that they were eating. So for them, the wilderness was so dry. The wilderness was arid. The wilderness had no life. Then why would God bring them to the wilderness, for goodness sake? Why? You know, these were the Israelites that cried to God. They cried that they were under serious burden of the Egyptians. The Egyptians were lording it over them. The Egyptians were putting them to hard tasks. And so they were really, really feeling the heat of slavery. And they called to God. And God gave them Moses. He said, Moses, you know, take these guys out. These are my people. And I've heard their cry. And so I'm going to deliver them. Take them out to the land of Canaan, the promised land, the land that will flow with milk and honey. Take them there. But you know, on the way, that kind of journey may not be easy, may be windy, you know. When you're going to a land you never know before, have you been to any place you don't know before? Huh? And you're going to visit the place for the very first time without a GPS. I mean, without a GPS. Except God and the leader, Moses, gave it to them. So you have to listen, okay? You got to listen to instructions, or else you'll be lost. How faithful are you to listen to your GPS? Tell me, like on a scale of 1 to 10. How many? Oh, really? Like 10, 10? 10. If it's 9.5, what happens? That means you're already heading home. You're already home. Like, oh, no, I know this place, you know. Huh? But if you're going to an unknown destination, unknown, and he said, go right. Oh, wow. Oh, boy, oh, boy. Assuming you get to your workplace, and the place is blocked. Huh? And it's recalculating. Recalculating. And they say, I hope I get the next turn, you know, to find my path. But in doing this, we so much trust our GPS. And you don't want to listen to it 9.5 times, but 10 over 10, so that you can find your way. So Moses was the GPS used by God, like sacramentally, that the people can see, that they can and trust him and listen to him. So they cried, we don't have food here. Look, you brought us to this forsaken place. We are tired of this. We need to get back to where we eat food. Because for the people, all they cried for, all that concerned them was food. Food for the stomach. Sometimes, if you want to get people to attend a mass, have breakfast after mass. Is that right? Because communion, the body and blood of Christ, may not be enough. You see, that is a crisis. Isn't it a crisis? When communion, the body and blood of Christ, is not enough. Tell me, we think that the feel, the energy that we derive, and the pleasure derive from eating whatever breakfast. You know, I love pancakes, maybe pancakes, you know. That probably fills you up till lunch, isn't it? 4 or 5 hours. And Jesus today, when he was accosted by these guys, you know, they had enough to eat. They had enough to eat. And they said to him, when did you get here? They want more. He's a miracle worker. They want more of food to fill their bellies. And Jesus looked at them and said, you know what? That's not the most important. No. The gospel acclamation catches it very, very well. Man must not live by bread alone, but by what? By every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. The GPS is instruction. The GPS is listening. The GPS is to listen to every word that comes from that GPS. 10/10, like, because you're gonna go lost. You're gonna go lost. You're gonna get lost. And so many people are lost in the world today, don't you think? How many people live in Buffalo? How many people are in church today? How many people live around here? How many people are sleeping in now? They're not listening to any GPS anymore. How many people wake up in the morning and they just grab their cup of coffee and sit with it? Wow, this guy's gonna get me through the day. This coffee is gonna get me through the day. Gotta get my favorite mug of coffee. And actually, Venerable Fulton Sheen said that many years ago, said, you know, you cannot get an American to sing, to pray, to do sports, to read anything except until after a glass of coffee. So which one do you trust? To begin your day, first and foremost, fervently with a glass of coffee or with a time of prayer? Which one? Which one gets you through the day? A glass of coffee or a moment of prayer? I need you guys to follow me and think along with me. You know, you think along with me. Some guys get enough energy from the coffee. Maybe it doesn't last. Sometimes, you know, you got to go to an interview or an appointment. And it's not an appointment. Cup of coffee. You have your favorite place. Oh, that is Mama's favorite place. That's Papa's favorite place. Favorite. And what do you do there? Your leg up. Put your leg up, the coffee here, and that, what do you call those kind of books? Those books that I was talking about. Wild stories that never happen. Fiction. That's what it is. I love my fiction, they say. That's what you hear. I have my favorite book club, girls and boys. We read fictions, we fancy fictions. Jesus says today, they ask him, what can we do to accomplish the works of God? What can we do to accomplish the works of God? Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, that you believe in the one he sent. Believe in the one he sent. Believe, trust in the one you sent. He sent. Have faith in the one he sent, not in your coffee. Not your favorite meal. Trust in the one he sent.
He said he gave them bread from heaven.
Yes.
But for the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. The one that came down from heaven is called Jesus Christ. He came down from heaven. And he wants us to trust him always. When you are in temptation, when you are in doubt, when you are afraid, who do you turn to? Your coffee?
More questions.
So you have a 21-year-old smart kid in college and comes back to you every now and then to discuss the goings on in college, to discuss new friends, to discuss his or her job. What will you feel? How will you feel as a parent when your child, for 21, discusses his or her itinerary and discusses the goings on in his or her life? How would you feel as a parent? Huh? Pretty good? Wow. That's how God feels when we talk to him. That's how we make him feel when we converse with him. Because we trust in him. Because we have a special friendship with him. Because we have confidence in sharing our lives. And he wants to discuss our lives with us.
You know where this Bible was taken from?
Where?
In the gathering area.
Yeah, gathering area. Yeah. Probably just. You know what? You know how we treat the Bible? And this word of life. The word of life. And actually at the time when I made the decision to look for a Bible, my eye went there. In the soil. Because while I was in adoration this morning, between 6:30 and 7:30, the Lord was telling me how to bring out some Bible passages to speak to you guys. Bible passages, which is the word of life. Man must not live by bread alone, but by the word that proceeds from the mouth of God. When your child comes to have this conversation with you, you guys are able to talk around stuff, okay? And guide them. And talk about your own experiences and how to move, and your own days in college and things like that. And your child is nourished and nurtured and strengthened and can live by your dreams and live even within your own dreams and allow your dreams to guide, even though they have their own dreams. But they are at least to share from your own experience. They do not say, I'm 21, I can have my kind of year now. I don't need papa and mama anymore. Those kind of kids, what do you do? You have help. You have help, but they're not ready to receive help from you. How do you feel as a parent? How do you feel? You feel helpless and rather than frustrated. God is frustrated even in some cases now. Because he has to help. He's our helper. He's our healer. He's the power that saves us. He's the one that takes care of us. But he wants to give us all this abundance of life. But we wouldn't let him. Because we're not conversing with him. We're not conversing with him. Wow. When are we going to open our Bibles? When are we going to see the fruit of life? When shall we see what he wants for us? When shall we perceive what he desires of us? Psalm 91. Whoever goes to the Lord for safety, whoever remains under the protection of the Almighty, can say to him, you are my defender and protector. The first verse. You are my defender and protector. Do you consider God as your defender and protector? Or you think you're alone, isolated, thrown into the wild to fend for yourself?
Favorite verse, favorite psalm, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. So the GPS is your shepherd, okay? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. That's when you listen, okay? That's when you listen to the GPS. That's when you focus on the GPS. That's when you will not want. If you don't focus on the GPS, I tell you, you will want. You will want. You will wander and go wild and turn away and lost. How do we live our lives today? Listening to God or listening to ourselves or listening to our favorite pastime and circumstances that are devoid and away from you? You are my God. In you I trust. We go to share with the one we trust. We go to fellowship with the one we trust. We build friendship with the one we trust. We listen to the one we trust. Not all this pastime. What do you call those things that, you know, now, I said it time and time again, and I give you a homily. You see Linda doing a wonderful job doing the recording of that. And you don't follow your priest even online. You don't follow your priest, but you have your favorite. What do you call those things? Podcast. Sometimes they are garbage. I mean, garbage. But you just love to listen to them all the time. Oh, he makes me feel good. No. God is not interested in making you feel good. Sitting on those tables there, I see, you know, consecration to the Blessed Man, and we talk about it. Before Mass, we begin the rosary, and people just don't want to. The rosary is not my kind of thing. Everything that gives you life, you don't want it. I remember there was one day here. Ash Wednesday, and of course, the weather was not clement, so we couldn't have our, what do you call those things to do on Ash Wednesday, or before Ash Wednesday? We couldn't have it. And the first Sunday of Lent, I walked in and I saw the whole place was like a feast. I said, what's going on here? They said, we didn't have Mardi Gras on Ash Wednesday. The weather was not. So we're going to have it today. We couldn't skip Mardi Gras that year. But I do not know how many masses you have skipped. How many communions you have skipped. How many times it has been announced here that we have adoration of the Blessed Sacrament. It doesn't bother you. Because it doesn't improve your life. That's where life is. That's where life is. We celebrate today St. Alphonsus. St. Alphonsus, I told them, we're celebrating St. Alphonsus today, the feast day of St. Alphonsus, not St. Peter's, but he has wonderful words for us. And St. Alphonsus says, he who trusts himself is lost. He who trusts himself is lost. He who trusts in God can do all things. And you want to do all things. I want to do all things. Why not trust in God? To help him, to do them, to accomplish them, to achieve them. Listen to what he says. I think I'm going to conclude on that. Your God is ever beside you. Your God is ever beside you. Call on him. Speak to him. Talk to him. Converse with him. Pray. Acquire the habit of speaking to God as if you were alone with him. Familiarly and with confidence. And love as to the dearest and most loving of friends. Speak to him often of your business, your plans, your troubles, your fears, of everything that concerns you. Everything that concerns you. Everything. Your family, the children. The ones that are going to church with you, the ones that oppose you, the ones that don't know what to do with your church. Talk to them about your husband, about your wife. Don't talk to someone else about them. Converse with him confidently and frankly. For God is not one to speak to a soul that does not speak to him. God does not speak to a soul that does not speak to him. Do you speak to people who don't speak to you? You don't. You just walk your way. It's like he knows me all the time. Someone ignores you. Sometimes you don't go beyond yourself to speak to them. Speak to God. And we speak.